It's 4 o'clock in the Monday, and you know what that means. It's time for another exciting episode of Taxi TV Live. This week, the special guest star, Michelle Bell. Yeah. I always feel sorry for our guests. Welcome to the big show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I'm thrilled that you're here. I've known Michelle for about 3 years, I think. She's been part of our A&R team here. And oh, let's get the chat room open. And we all adore her. And I think the first week she was here, I walked up and grabbed her hair and said, "I'm sorry, but I love your hair." And she's just got awesome hair. And she didn't sue me or hit me. So I was pretty happy about that. But what can I say? Look, she's got cool hair. And hello to all you guys in the chat room. And yes, I saw somebody mention right before we went on the air, it is Grammy night. So, okay, we won't run long. As hard as that will be for me, because you know I can get a little chatty. So we're going to get right down to it, and I'm going to hit Michelle with some questions, and then during the course of the show, we've got three songs that we're going to listen to, and Michelle will critique them, give feedback. She's a hit songwriter. Where did my notes go? Here they are. Just to remind you guys, in case you joined the show and haven't read the email, as a pop songwriter and producer, Michelle's talents have contributed to the sale of over 40 million albums worldwide. Just some of the artists she's written and produced for include Jennifer Lopez, Britney Spears, Sean Combs, Timbaland, Mary J., Paulina Rubio, Macy Gray, Bilal, Nas. Is it Nas or Nas?
Nas.
Nas. And Nelly Furtado. Funny, I can pronounce her name. Her film and TV credits include Behind the Music, CBS NFL Football, Fast Money on CNBC, Late Night with Jimmy Fallon, Bridesmaids, Fame, the movie, NCAA Basketball, Teen Choice Awards, America's Best Dance Crew, Home Depot, she was sawing and hammering, MTV, BET, ESPN, ABC, CW, The CW, VH1, Weight Watchers, All My Children, which, by the way, Jack Montgomery, one of the stars, well, his character is Jack Montgomery, was my best friend in junior high and high school, and he went on to be a big soap opera star, so I'm almost famous by proxy. She's also had stuff on Nickelodeon, Kodak commercial, and many, many more. You've also gone on tour with a lot of artists singing, right?
I have a lot of background gigs.
Right.
I did David Letterman with Fergie.
Yeah.
And MTV Awards, and yeah, it's been fun. It's been fun.
I never will go out on the road with anybody. I did once do a 3 or 4 day recording gig with the ladies from Heart, but and they tried to make me go in the gear truck. And I said, airplanes for me. So that was as close to touring as I ever came. But Michelle, you know, some people are just easy to respect, and she's one of them. The first time I met her, I think I trotted back down to the office and I looked up her bio online and went, wow, this lady has done some really cool stuff. And she's the very definition of self-made. So I'm going to ask her to tell you the story of how she broke into the business. You were from Ohio, right?
Yes.
And take it from there.
Great. Yeah, originally from Ohio, and I knew I always wanted to be in the music business. I just love music. I have a lot of musicians in my family, and I always sang growing up in my church and, you know, school talent shows and that whole thing. I really started to take it serious. I think for me it was kind of a combination of business and music. Everything was networking. I lived in Ohio, and at that time, it wasn't like how it is now where you can just call for free.
Right.
So they charged for long-distance calling. So I still lived at home with my parents. I wasn't really out of high school yet, but I would, you know, the numbers were on the back of the albums, and it was, you know, I would find Warner Brothers Records, and if I could get somebody on the phone, I would always ask them. I kind of learned by doing. If I got somebody on the phone, I would ask them, how do I get my songs in? And I think it's just kind of, they get that call a million times a day.
Do you think?
But, I mean, yeah, a million times a day. But I was fortunate enough to get someone who would give me somebody's name, or they would say, this is what you want to ask for. So then the next time I would call back with more information. And for me, it was just a networking thing. If I could get one person on the phone, I felt like I could get someone from them to call. And then when I got that person on the phone, I would ask them for another contact.
Right.
So yeah, I ran up my parents' phone bill to about $1,200.
Whoa.
And yeah, it was $1,200. And but the cool thing is I started getting calls back. Like, you know, I would come in, at the time I was staying at home and going to college, and I would come home and my mother would say, somebody from Warner Brothers called, I'm not your secretary. And this one from Interscope called, and it was like, oh my God, like, you know, I was freaking out. But
Where in Ohio did you live?
I lived in Canton, Ohio, Football Hall of Fame.
Exactly a music capital, right?
Not at all. I got really fortunate, too, because I was in a writing program when I was at Kent State University, and I kind of went to school early. I went to college early from high school, and they had an internship program for writing. So,
like legit writing?
Yes, legit. It was the Akron Beacon Journal was the name of the newspaper, and when I started working with them, it was just kind of part-time as an intern, and they had letterhead. So I noticed that the entertainment editor never wanted to go to any shows that I wanted to see, like hip-hop or R&B, or they mainly just kind of did very, like, the big huge stars, if it was the Rolling Stones or Mariah Carey was coming or something like that. But anything that was kind of up and coming, they didn't want to do it. So for me, it saved money on my parents' phone bill if I would call from that Akron Beacon Journal office. And I started using their letterhead to say, hey, I work in the entertainment department. And one day the entertainment editor came to me and said, you know, we've been getting a lot of calls about this writer who's been going to all these shows, and like they're calling for you, the labels are calling for you now. And it was cool. I mean, they were great about it, but I got to meet a ton of people going to these shows, and I got tickets and just networking. Everything came down to networking. I just met more and more people. And by the time I got to New York, I had friends that I had met on the phone. And it's interesting now because with social media, there's such a bigger, it's kind of the same thing, but on such a grand scale, because you can reach out to people so much easier, and you can email, or you can follow them, you can Instagram or Twitter or Facebook or whatever it is. So,
but you probably had some advantage in that not that many people got through the receptionist wall at the major labels back then. So you were in a small group of people who had some entree, versus today it's like, yeah, you could have 1,000 friends in the industry, but they're friends.
Yeah. You know what? I think it's your approach. Like, I've had people that write to me on LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever it is, and it's your approach. I think if you're just kind of selling something is not always the best way. If you're sending in a bunch of links and look at my press
check it out,
and look at my, sometimes it's a more personal approach. And these people on the phone, what's your name? How's your day going? Just kind of asking them personal, not really too personal, but then I would remember it. So next time I would call back, I'd say, hey, you know, gatekeeper, oh, how'd it go last week? Or how's your mom doing? Or did you get the dog? Or, you know, and they would, it's like, wow, you remember something. And also they're busy, they're in the middle of their day, but it's like somebody just took a second to ask how they're doing and remembered a small thing about their life. So that was always really helpful.
Classic sales stuff. And you're right. It's the soft sell. I've always found asking them questions about them makes them like you better. Because it's usually all about me, so make it about them, and that was quite an accomplishment. So when you left Akron and, Canton, and went to New York, how did you make that transition going from being this kid, you know, on the Akron,
I lived in Canton, but it was the Akron Beacon Journal. Beacon Journal. Yeah, the Beacon Journal. Also the Canton Repository, really great newspaper. I had friends that I'd met over the phone. And when I got there, I just, you know, I was really good about sending personal handwritten letters to say hello, to follow up. Thank you for the call. Thank you for the time. At one point, I was doing confetti letters where they would open it up and a bunch of confetti would fall out. It was a huge mess, but they would remember that.
I bet they would.
Just got confetti all over my floor, all over everything. Who is this?
Don't ever send me glitter. Every year during the holidays, I get the glitter stuff. No, don't send glitter, because I've still got glitter in my carpet. Apparently, the cleaning crew doesn't do a great job. Confetti's big enough you can kind of pick it up. So you got off the plane, the bus, whatever, and what was your very first big meeting?
So my first big meeting, I had a friend who was a journalist. Her name was Christy Barber, and she worked for Def Jam. She worked with a guy, Chris Blackwell, who is, you know, he signed Bob Marley. He is Island Records is Chris Blackwell.
He just passed away. I've gotten confused with somebody else, but yes.
Okay.
I worked at Criteria in the 70s and met Chris because he brought a lot of the Island groups there because it was the closest studio to the islands. Anyway.
Nice. Yeah. So I met her and I had only visited New York probably one time. And she was like, I have an apartment in my building and you should stay here. So I really moved there sight unseen. I had no idea where I was going to be living. I knew nothing about the neighborhood. I just went for it.
How old were you?
Oh, 19 years old, actually. I turned
pretty ballsy
in New York. Yeah.
Good
it was
for you.
Oh, my parents were furious, to say the least. But it was a good move. Just networking. I met a publicist who worked for Universal, and between her and Christy, they really both helped me. I just met a lot of people. I worked for a woman, Marvette Brito, who's a publicist, and I met a lot of people with her, and Carl Kanai was my first sort of job where I got the opportunity to meet more music business people. So I still had to have a job in the midst of trying to make it in the music business.
Right,
I've had so many jobs. It is just, I mean, I worked in fashion. There just wasn't anything that I wouldn't do to make it. And for me, it was like, sure, I'll work from 9 to 5 and still work at the studio at night. Or, I mean, it was just second nature. I really wanted to make it. And once there was a guy by the name of Jeff Tweedy who worked with Carl Kanai, and he said he was going to a new company called Sean John. And I was just kind of their assistant and intern, and just, I wasn't great. I was a horrible assistant, a horrible intern,
really?
But I think very likable. So they took me with them.
I'm surprised you were horrible because you seem very businesslike and professional and you follow through, you know.
I was, but you know what, assistants and interns, it was about getting coffee and answering the phone. So I wanted to be in the meeting and talk to people about my ideas, and they were like, we're still waiting on the coffee, and did you get the donuts or are you going to get the bagels? Or what are you going to do? So that was kind of my start. But once I got to Sean John, we were in the BMG building, and I just worked every floor. It was publishing, there were labels, and again, it was networking, but also putting people together, which I think is kind of my strong suit. It helped me with collaboration in music because if there was someone, the BMG publishing office was there and I wanted to learn. So I would bring them clothes and they would, I mean, it was like exclusive. This is a brand new line. You know, we had samples, we had sweatshirts, whatever I could use to get this person to sit down with me and talk to me. That's what I used everything that I had. So by the end of probably the first year, I was friends with so many people in that building and still to this day.
I call that positive manipulation. When you're using, you know, like sweatshirts, cool hoodies. Okay, so you're using that to get to them, but they're benefiting the company. Sean John's benefiting because now their stuff is on cool people who are going out to clubs and spreading the word about the brand.
Yes.
Everybody wins.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it was a thing where Sean actually, someone that worked for him, Jessica Rivera, who's a really great A&R, she put me in the studio. I was kind of already working with some of his producers, and I had met Kanye, who was just starting and was still very much the way that he is now.
I was just going to ask you, was he that cocky
then? My first conversation with him, side note, I met him through Derek Angeletti, who's a producer who did all this great stuff. And Derek said, I want you to meet Michelle. She lives in New Jersey, and I think you guys should connect. And I wanted to connect because during that time, the studio was like on 25th Street in New York, and it was kind of you kind of had to walk down a dark street to get to the train. I didn't have a car then, so I wanted to commute with him. He stayed in the studio late, and so did I. Our first conversation, it was like, hi, I'm Michelle. So Derek says that you're from Chicago. So what do you do? Do you sing? Do you rap? And he was like, I'm an artist. I'm the best. I'm the greatest. I'm a rapper. I'm a singer. I'm a designer. I went to art school, and he had his portfolio and showed it to me. And he's like, I write. I can do everything. In 5 minutes, he told me his whole plan to take over the world. And I was like, okay, well, I write and I sing, but I also take the train to New Jersey. So if you want to take the train with me, that'd be great, you know, sometimes at night. But no, his ego was, he's the exact same person that he was all those years ago. Yeah.
Well, worked out for him.
Yes, it did. Absolutely.
And so, how did you, what was your first co-write and how did that happen?
My first co-write, I wasn't that great at writing, I'll be honest. I had a lot of good ideas, but I didn't know how to work in the studio. I didn't know how to lay down my ideas. It would take me like 6 or 7 hours to record a song. I had a few people that sat with me and said, no, this is how you write. Let's start with the verse. Let's get our melody first. Let's find one melody and stick to it and repeat it over and over until it feels right. And then after we did that, now let's write the lyrics. And then we would go to the chorus and, you know, let's write the chorus. And I just had two great writers who helped me. They were with the Bad Boy Camp and they were also, one was just a really good friend that just kind of sat me down and said, you've got all the ideas, but too many words, too many lyrics, too much happening here. You've got to scale it back and focus. And that's how I learned. So my first real collaboration, it was kind of me on my own with tracks. Mm-hmm. I would say my first real collaboration, it wasn't with anyone who was really huge. My first placement, though, I knew when I wrote the song, I just knew when I was writing it, this is different than anything I've ever done. I knew that the lyrics are coming to me fast, but I also knew that there's a feeling on this. There's something that is just very distinct. It's just taking no time to write this. It was very simple, very easy, but I also knew this is in the pocket. It's simple. It's effortless almost. And that was the first song that really got me noticed. It was the first song that was on the radar for Sean Combs. He was dating Jennifer Lopez at the time, and Jessica played it for him. I mean, by then I was great in the BMG building. My name was probably out there before my songs were. So
that's the way kind of it should go.
Yeah.
You know, if you're doing all the work, right?
Yeah, that was it. The setup was great, but I really needed to deliver with the song. And that first song, I knew it before I even played it for him. And the other thing that I knew, that the guy that I collaborated with, he knew it too. And I think he had already been in the business for a while, Kip Collins. He had been in the business and I think he had been kind of burned before. So he was a little bit nervous. He was like, I'm afraid for you to play these songs for people and I don't know how they're going to take it. And, I don't want someone like Puffy to steal my song. And I was like, no, you got to trust me. I know that this is the one. I've played them other things and they like it. And I took it in and right away it was just, I got the call the same day. I was like,
wow,
working downstairs in the office and it was like, Puff wants to see you. And it was like, what? He wants to see me? And my boss is like, what? You go for it. And he loved it. Jennifer wow. loved it. She cut it. I went in and it was just like, I can't believe this is happening. She did it and changed everything.
So how long did it take? Well, what was the song?
Come Over. Come Over was my first song with Jennifer Lopez.
And how long from the day you set foot in New York City until that happened, how long?
That was 4 years, to be honest. Yeah.
I mean, it sounds like it was 4 months from the story you just told. So that's great info because it just shows that, you hung in there.
Yeah.
You didn't get back on the bus to Canton.
No.
And you didn't give up.
No.
You did all the right steps.
And I had to get better. And even after that song, I still had to get better. Because then it's like you set the bar so high. And I still, it's like after that, it wasn't like all the songs are hits. Then it
was just like magically pop out like it.
So. Yeah, I kind of focused in and realized this is what it should always feel like. If I don't have this feeling, then I need to work harder or try harder. And it was tough because then I became kind of a collaborator that, and I'm still like that. It's like, no, that's not good enough. No, that's not good enough. And sometimes I don't always have the right lyric, but I'm a believer in let's wait for it. So you're sitting there and it's like, let's not force it. It'll just come. It's kind of, it's an energy almost that's in the air. When you have that right lyric, you just know, it's gonna feel right for both you and the collaborator, and you can't try to force it into the melody, or it just makes sense and I'll just wait for it. And I feel like it always comes from talking. I love a really good conversation with my co-writer. that's how the lyrics come.
That was one of my questions I've got on paper, which is, you know, describe a typical collaboration. You've got two people, you agree to work together, you figure out a space, whether it's somebody's apartment or a coffee shop or a conference room after hours. You both walk into the room, how you doing, how was your day, and then what happens? Where do you go from there?
For me, I need to talk. I need to connect with you. I need to just kind of plug into you and see what you're about. And even writing by myself, I have to sort of get into a zone of, you know, it's like talking it out. Like you have a conversation, and some of the greatest lyrics just come about in conversation. Someone will say something and it's like, that's the lyric right there. You talk about, what do you like to do? It's not always love or, you know, what's your family like? Or sometimes it's just, how was your day? Or, you know, what'd you do this weekend? And something will just come out of it. So I like to have a good conversation, feel that person out.
Do you have the melody before you start the conversation? Or does it literally start with the conversation and then you wrap a melody around an idea? How does that all work?
So melody for me, that is the crucial and critical. I was just talking with a songwriter earlier about this. The melody is, that's where you start. Especially with pop music.
Sorry, I've got to move this.
Go for it.
I'm getting irradiated from the reflection.
No problem. Especially for pop music, that melody is the key. That's what everybody sings along to. Some people don't remember the lyrics. I am really bad at lyrics. So I can hear the best, it's my favorite song on the radio. I don't remember the lyrics. I don't know the lyrics at all. I don't remember them. So for me, melody always registers first. And when you find that great melody, then the lyrics just kind of fall into place, but it always starts with melody. So it depends on the co-write. In Nashville, or a lot of singer-songwriters, it's always guitar or piano first. So when starting from scratch that way, someone will play something. I don't play guitar, so if someone's playing the guitar, you just kind of find the melodies together, and then again, it's singing it over and over. We like this part, then where does it go from there? If it's a track, it's tough because if I'm with a songwriter and they love it, your first mind is always your best mind. That's what I think. Mm-hmm. So for me, I like to hear it in my brain before I sing it out because I work with a lot of great singers who are writers. And when you're a good singer, you can have 100 melodies that will just come out. And I feel like those first 5 melodies, those are the right ones, but you've already thrown them out and you didn't attach it and we didn't grab it. So now when we go back in, it's like the 20th melody is not the best one.
Right.
So sometimes I found this is why I like to talk to people. Let's get comfortable because this isn't a competition and it isn't a race. Whoever has the best melody, we're collaborators and we have to go with that. If it's you, if it's me, it doesn't matter who it is. It has to feel right for the song. So I find that some people in their own insecurities will start singing 20 melodies just to say, hey, I can do this, I can do this. And those aren't always... It's like that melody was the one, but if I'm like, yeah, let's go with that one, then they're like, no, I can do this all day, and then we're going to be here all day. I like to choose a great melody and then write the song from there because the first line of your lyric, if it's coupled with a killer melody, that's your start. And whether it's the first line of the song from the verse or whether it's a chorus, it's the marriage of that melody and that lyric together. So when you find a killer melody, go with that. Don't try to write your whole song in one sitting.
I did a show with Taxi member Steve Barton at his house and just had him lay down a swampy instrumental cue. And it was remarkably simple. And it was just an acoustic guitar and a little dobro part. And people, I mean, we had over 1,000 people watch that in this past week. And I got so many emails from people saying, oh, I've been over-composing and over-producing. Yes, you have. You said simple twice in 5 minutes, and that's probably the most overlooked thing in the music industry, maybe, is that simplicity sells. And a lot of people think of that as dumbing it down. No, I don't think it's dumbing anything down. The human mind, our soul, our being, the fibers in our body want to hear simple, repetitive things that we move to or we remember. And why beat it into the ground? You're right. you know what? We're going to talk. Michelle also is a vocal producer, so I'm going to segue into that from this, which is I always found in the studio that I would tell somebody to warm up to get a level on the mic, and I would record that first pass because frequently that was the killer pass because they weren't thinking about it. They weren't overdoing it. They were just letting it come out, and you capture lightning in a bottle and then go back and fix a few sections, and you've got it. You'd have to let them do the other 20 or 30 or 50 takes until they were then burnt out enough to realize the first one had magic. So as a vocal producer, how do you treat that? What's your approach as a vocal producer? Because you're trying to get somebody, I'm guessing most of the time you produce vocals, it's a song that you've written.
Yes.
And you hear it in your head the way it should be. And now you're standing in a room or on the other side of the glass from some big star. How do you get them to trust you to keep it simple, stupid, the old KISS formula?
Acting. I think it's kind of like it's tough when they didn't write the song. If it's an artist who is taking on someone else's idea, it's almost like they're an actor and they have to act it out. For me, I have just techniques that I love to use. Raising eyebrows will always raise your voice. Lifting your finger will always...
Good to know.
Yeah. These are I love these tips. If you notice, Mariah Carey always... She does this thing where she's always kind of drawing...
Painting the notes. Yeah,
she's painting the notes. And that's always... You're always going to stay in pitch. If you can paint it, when you raise your eyebrows, that raises it. Some people will raise their whole, you know, face. For me, if I want a happier sound, smile. Smiling when singing always brings out a higher tone in your, you know, it's just a higher timbre. So those are kind of my key things, but I think it's, people can hear the difference if I say smile or if I say more of a mean face or my mother used to always say like an ugly face sometimes with singing gets, you know, a little bit more soulful, a little bit more grit, but it really comes down to kind of acting it out. Even I call it the Justin Timberlake, like the boy band pull down. It's effective. It just kind of, when someone is, you can hear when someone, especially with a pop or an R&B song, dancing, a little bit of sort of movement makes a difference because you're going to stay on the beat and in the pocket. And it's just, those are things for me, I think, as a vocal producer that is, it is very helpful.
It had to be scary. Do you remember who the first person was that you produced vocally? And how scary was that, you know, assuming that it was somebody pretty big and now you're directing them? I mean, how do you get over with that? Because, like, who are you? There, you know, that's J-Lo over there.
Yeah. So with J-Lo, I was still pretty new. I did not have the chance to vocal produce her the first time. The second go around, we spent a great deal of time together. My first, probably the biggest artist was Britney. And she was really so down to earth that it was really easy. Also, in terms of acting, I have to say she just got it. She almost taught me because I felt like she had listened to the demo so many times that she knew how to take my voice and make it her own, but still sort of reach almost the beats that she knew. How to reach those sort of moments where it was like, this has really got to feel like this to have an impact. It was the impact that she was going for. So was I nervous? Yes, I was like completely freaking out. But I think for me, once I get into the music, I just kind of forget. I forget that they are this person. And I mean, this is going to sound really cocky, but I felt like every time I felt like I deserve to be here and it's my song. It's almost like I would just kind of take ownership of it. Like, you have to do it like this. And then after it was over, it was like, did that just happen? That was Britney Spears. And I told her, no, not like that. No. It's like, it's weird. Or Jennifer or whoever it is. There's a little bit of intimidation, but once I got past that, it's like, no, I'm into it. And I don't see you as who you are anymore. It's about the song.
Britney and I bumped tushies one day in an antique mall somewhere out here or in the Caneo Valley. We're both in this cramped little area and our butts touched. And she went, oh, excuse me. And I turned around. It was Britney Spears. That's as close to Britney as I've ever gotten.
That's hilarious.
You live in LA long enough, you're bound to bump somebody's butt sooner or later, or they're going to rear end you in a car on the freeway.
Yeah,
let's see how we're doing. Wow, we've already done a half an hour. All right, let's do a little song listening. So let us start out with, where did my lyrics go? As usual, I'm not going to mention the writer or artist's name. We're just going to mention song title. And we do this, you know, because it's about the information, not about making anybody, unless it's a really, really good critique, then we'll, no. Anyway, the song is called Take a Chance, and it is a top 40 pop song. And come on, you can do it. Play.
My smile is gonna win a war. You come up close to me and slowly when we start to sweat. I feel the father, you're gonna be the teacher's pet. Now that you win, we're together, we're invincible. But it doesn't matter that we're strangers and our principles. We're so far, different song, music, distance, and turn off. Oh, tell me, baby, can you feel that? I want you.
Famous Lasco Taxi TV fade. We've heard all the sections of the song at this point, so what do you think?
Great. So I'll say this. I'd like to start with the production.
Okay.
The production is great. It's innovative. It's really contemporary. It sort of is, right now, what we're seeing in music, there's kind of a trend. It's a hybrid of pop and electro and R&B and hip-hop and rock with some sort of rock elements. It's like things are kind of getting, you know, moving together. The one thing with this song, I think, that stood out to me, two things. And I find this a lot, and this is something that I, you know, work on too with other writers, limiting ourselves. I would say the talking moments of like the take a chance. It starts with the take a chance, take a chance. So in the beginning, the opening, I think that people get a little nervous that somebody isn't going to listen all the way through unless they have a vocal from the start of the song. I would say no vocal. And here's why. Talking it in a song is something that is, it's tricky. It's kind of an outdated concept, but sometimes it can be made cool, but it depends on the song, like a Bruno Mars song where he's sort of doing this talking thing. But that was also kind of a time, it was kind of, he was trying to be retro and it really fit the style of that. In this one, I think the take a chance in the beginning, I'd like to not hear the talking part because I don't want it to be too limiting, because it's like once you get past that, the phrasing in the verses, great. It's very rhythmic. There's some slower parts. It's like, and then when the music changes into the chorus, we go from a faster tempo to a slower tempo, which is really cool, really unique. Kind of keeps people, it's very danceable. Mm-hmm. I would just say that, the talking is, it's tough because it gives it a little bit of a dated sound, but talking does that for everybody's song. It's not just this song. It's like you can have an amazing song, but the talking can kill it sometimes. The other thing is this, in the Take It Chance, and then it says, I want you, and it sounds like a pre-chorus. To me, it's like super catchy melody that's catchy, but then I want to hear a chorus right after that.
Yeah.
This kind of has a really, almost like a little bit of a Katy Perry kind of thing, because it kind of goes slow and then it goes fast. But then right after the I want you, I want some super, I mean, it could be, it doesn't have to be a super high poppy chorus, but just a long note or something repetitive. I just feel like something should happen there. It's a little bit anticlimactic. God, I can't even say it. There's no climax.
It's all right. It's taxi TV. I can't say half the stuff I intend to say on the show. They're used to it.
Right, don't play the little boo on me. But no. yeah, but it that's what I thought. But the phrasing is good, and the verses, all of that's very contemporary, very current. I actually like that a lot. I would just say be careful of things that are trendy, because melodies, timeless, you know, lyrics that are just sort of fun and friendly, timeless. When you get into slang words, anything that people are sort of doing now, low voices where they're whispering, or any kind of talking, whispering, that sort of thing, unless it's a full-on rap, that's a tough sell.
Somebody once said to me, and I've repeated it 1,000 times probably on the show, which is always think 1.5 years out when you're writing or producing, because whatever you're hearing on the radio now, first of all, a lot of people are doing stuff that was, you know, sounds like it would have been 5 years ago. The smarter people tend to do what sounds like it's happening now, but that's even dated. By the time you would ever get that cut and the record would get made and it would go through its whole startup cycle, you've got to think 1.5 years or 2 years out and be 15% ahead of today's curve so that you don't sound dated, which is, I think so many people don't think in terms of how do I avoid being dated. Is that something that you think of as a writer, as a producer? Is it already in your being, in your soul, in your makeup that you already aren't dated? It just comes out of you sounding not dated, or do you have to work at being not dated?
No, I have to work at that. Everybody has to work at that. Two things that I don't do, no trendy, no talking, no too many ad-libs. Okay. Ad-libs come and go. Some years there are songs with lots of ad-libs. Some years there are songs with no ad-libs. Never put ad-libs in the very beginning of the song unless they're tiny and your demo singer is, like, incredible. Too many ad-libs is bad. But for me, staying current, you know, I've had songs that I always tell people when I'm screening that you can always have the song reproduced. So a good melody and a good lyric is timeless. Mm-hmm. I've placed songs that are 6 and 7 years old because somebody reproduced it. Somebody just, I had a couple of songs that a good friend of mine just stripped down and just played them on piano. So it's all lyrics and melody just on the piano. And it's like, wow, this is a completely brand new song. So for me, I always stay away from slang. I try not to do anything trendy because the feeling of having a good time, that's timeless. Everybody's going to go out with their friends, timeless. It's just always finding a way to say it that's a little bit kind of unique and simple. It's like being original but simple at the same time is a really tough balance.
That's a craft in and of itself.
It is.
You know, you could almost do a semester at college on keeping things simple, but being ahead of the trend.
It's true. It's true. You can always go back and reproduce, but keeping it simple is good.
You mentioned stripping something down. One of your songs was stripped down. Let's have that discussion now, because some people run listings with Taxi. Some A&R people, some producers will run listings and say, I'll listen to stripped down stuff. Other people want to hear full-blown productions that sound like a record. So first I want to talk about stripped down, and then I want to talk about the vocal quality on the demo. So first let's address the stripped down issue. I completely agree with you that there's a song I've played many, many times on the show, a country song that's the single best piano vocal demo I've heard in 41 years of being in the industry. You know it's a hit when you hear it, and it's nothing more than a piano and not a very good sounding one, and a Nashville demo singer that, as I always say, sings it from his toes, through his gut, through his heart, and out through his mouth, and it totally connects with you. Can the folks in our viewing audience, they always ask, how good does my stuff have to be as far as the production on the demo? Do you have a favored school of, do you lean towards stripped down or do you lean towards fully produced?
So, well, that's a tough one. It really depends on the song. I think for me, stripped down is a really great showcase for lyrics and melody.
Mm-hmm.
The good thing about it is if the A&R person and the artist has vision, a great melody and a great lyric is going to go somewhere, and you can almost hear it. Sometimes I hear things that are, I wish it was stripped down. I wish we could just hear the lyrics and the melody, because either the production is just not current enough. It's just not, I mean, it's like with contemporary pop production, drums are key. They're everything. And the bass line is,
yeah.
It's just, those are paramount. And you don't, it's like, sometimes it's better to just turn your song in and let someone else think about that or help you with that or put that together. So I think it depends on what they're pitching for, but there's nothing really beats a stripped down song, because you really get to hear the vocal, the melody, and the lyric. That being said, a lot of A&Rs, they want to hear a fully produced, I just had a conversation today where it was like a guy, you know, was going to send in songs for a female, and he's like, no, I think they hear it better when they hear the female, they hear her voice, they know exactly, you know, where her voice, how it's supposed to sound, where it's supposed to make an impact, basically. And I agree, but I also feel like a good song is just a good song. It doesn't, you know, matter who sang it, male or female, but stripped down is... It really showcases. In some places, stripped down can also hurt a song because it's hard to get the feel of an up-tempo pop song with just a piano. If it's an up-tempo thing, it's a little harder to portray that that vibe of a fully produced pop song.
Do you think about a target artist, a target A&R person, a target producer when you're writing? Do you think, well, you know, ultimately this is starting to sound like it's a Britney song or whomever, might you make your decision on ultimately who the first set of ears is going to be and who the next set of ears, let's say, you know, in Britney's case, that it's going to go through her A&R person and her manager and then ultimately to Britney. Do you think about those people because you may know them and know which approach would be more palatable to them?
Yes, the one thing I can say to that is don't think about anybody except
That's
yourself.
Right.
Don't think about any A&R people. Don't
no.
think about who's going to love it. Don't think about the audience. Don't think about the artist. You have to love it. And I feel like anytime I've ever, you know, sat down and wrote something for somebody specifically, all those songs are still in my hard drive. Anything that I ever wrote for myself, sometimes I've been embarrassed. Like my last production partner, Peter Wade, would always say, no, it's the stuff she's not playing. Like, no, play. Like, we would be in the studio with Jennifer, and he would say, I know Michelle's going to get all weird, but we wrote this song, and she doesn't want you to hear it because it's like she's embarrassed. And she would say, that's the one that I want to hear. And that was always the one that she wanted to sing, the ones that were like, I wrote this thing with you in mind. And it's like you're thinking too much about that artist or the world and or radio. I would always think
right.
about the radio and the formula, and this was going to be great on the dance floor. But the things that were just genuinely from my heart, maybe some of the lyrics were abstract or I didn't quite know how to say it, it just poured out. Those are the only ones really that have made me, I guess, successful.
You've made a lot of people out there in taxi land and the world in general very happy by saying that, and yet you and I... it's not just taxi. People point fingers, go, oh, you guys only want formulaic stuff. The industry wants stuff that is palatable for radio, that A&R people are going to hear and go, I can get the guys in the radio promotion department excited about this, which is part of the formula for success. And yet so many people go, you've forgotten about craft. You've forgotten about my artistry. And it's tough. We're not trying to tie anybody's hands behind their back when they work. We're not trying to force them into anything. It's just when, well, you know this. I mean, Michelle is also a publisher. The industry always uses a-las. find me something, you know, a la Britney's last record, but with a new twist. I mean, that's basically the brief that you see on the inside of the industry. Nothing like as evolved as the taxi listings, where we almost give you a roadmap. So what you're saying flies in the face of that, yet we live in an industry that gives writers, and I mean top-of-the-line hit songwriters, direction all the time. What are these guys supposed to do?
Throw that out the window. and I'll tell you why. A lot of times, the A&R people don't know what they want until they hear it. So they'll say, we want something like this. Or, you know, for years they were saying, Christina Aguilera was looking for records, and they kept saying Lauryn Hill. Mm-hmm. And then she comes out with the last record with Big Time Rush, and it was their record. But it's like, I could not really ever see her singing something like that. I think that they are looking for something that when they hear it and it's amazing and dynamic, they'll love it and they'll know it. And instead of sort of following or be like you're saying, thinking a year and a half ahead,
yeah,
is better than just kind of thinking about what's happening right now or what's on the radio right now. By the time your record even gets on their desk, it could be 3 months from now. So by the time, you know, this song gets to the radio, it could be a year from now. For me, it's just throw all that stuff out the window and write from your heart and write what's great, but also dig deep. For me, it's always rhyme schemes. Or conversational lyrics. I say that a lot because I'm sitting here talking to you. It's like, you know, I have a bad breakup or I'm going through something and I say, you know, and I'm telling you exactly how I feel. I'm not, thankfully, this year I'm not. I want to say it in my song exactly the way that I say it to you. And right. I feel like people don't do that when they're writing a love song. They go the poetry route, and it has to say, like, people use the word upon, or when have you ever been with a friend and was like, upon hearing his voice, I like, you wouldn't say
never.
That.
Yeah.
Never. You would never use that word. Or, you know, I will always fit. It's like, no one, you want to use words that you would actually say. And sometimes when you say it directly, and you, it's almost like, use the word gonna instead of I'm going to. It's like,
yeah,
you're not, when you're talking to a friend and you're really being emotional, you're not speaking in that way. Even if you're excited and happy about love, you're not speaking that way, or whatever it is that you're talking about, your subject matter.
You forget everything your English
yeah.
teacher ever taught you
yeah.
in high school.
Yeah, don't use the proper language. And I get that a lot with co-writers. They're always like, too smart. I have a friend, he's like, intellect, that's too intellectual. That's intellect. We don't want to hear the dumb it down, make it as dumb, you know. And I think sometimes you can fit in a really brilliant, smart word with the just most basic line, and it has an impact.
Don Henley, I think, is one of the most brilliant people at executing that in the history of songwriting. Don Henley can say a paragraph in 5 words or less.
Yes.
The guy's
yes.
amazing. He can give you goosebumps in 5 words or less. So now let's address the same subject, but from the perspective of the taxi members are going, see, I know those taxi screeners, they're listening to my stuff and they're rejecting it because of this one thing. You've been here for about 3 years. Is there anybody sitting in that room that if they heard something that wasn't what the label asked for, but was close enough to the ballpark and sounded like a hit, could you imagine any taxi screener ever going, well, this sounds like a massive hit, but I don't like the fact that they didn't use a contraction there, or, you know, I would
no.
change it.
No, no. We're listening for not just lyrics, we're listening for overall. So sometimes it's like, wow, the pre-chorus was a little weak, but you know what? That chorus is on. The verse is great, the phrasing's amazing, and this production is just, yes, this is a yes. Because, you know, the one thing I know is when you send it to a label or you send it to, even for film and TV, they'd make edits, they, you know, they'll work around it, but a great A&R or an artist, they're gonna take to it. They're gonna make it their own anyway, so. No, when things are strong, it's, you know, it's the same as us. A lot of us are writers here, and, you know, we hope that they'll hear this and see the great parts of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's tough too, because sometimes things come in well polished, the sound quality is great, but it's just lyrics, you know, it really comes
right.
down to lyrics or emotion, or the melody's just not, it's just kind of lingering. It's not really pushing forward. And I've heard demos where the singing's not that great, the mix is a little bad, but the lyrics are so strong and so great.
And that's what you'll forward,
yes,
right?
Yes, that's what I'll forward.
The members tend to latch on, I believe, and not all members, not all the time, but in many cases, we get these complaint emails from people or phone calls, and they're really upset. It's like your A&R person in a taxi had their head up their butt because they rejected it because of this one line. No, they rejected it because the whole thing wasn't working. It wasn't amazing. It didn't make the hair in your arm stand up. And they pointed out that one line because it was the most obvious fix. Start there. Is that a true statement that I'm making, just so they know?
Oh, definitely. And I think, you know, it's tough because as artists, we don't want to tear down other artists. We don't want to, we know that you're reading this, your fingers are crossed, just like when we send things in, my writers, their fingers are crossed. It's like everybody wants that forward. Everybody wants that yes.
Yeah.
So knowing that, it's like, we don't want to sit there and pick apart every single thing. And it's like, taxi members are very lucky because we can send things into I send things into A&Rs all the time. And if you don't hear back, that's a no. There is no formal rejection letter
right.
of I didn't like it or it was the pre-chorus. They're just, you just don't hear anything until they do like something,
yeah.
which can be really discouraging. So, you know, sometimes it's getting things back and somebody saying, you could take another look at the verse. That's more helpful than nothing at all. So
yeah,
taxi members have a real advantage.
It breaks. Well, I should ask you this in the form of a question. Doesn't it break all of our hearts every time we have to break somebody's heart?
Oh, it does. It does.
I kind of feel like people sit there and think, oh, those idiots at taxi, they're sitting there going, ha, ha, ha. You know, I held another person down by the shoulders and held them underwater today, and we're trying to screw with them in some horrible way. I mean, Michelle is representative
like
of the people listening to your music out in that room. They want to stand up. They want to run down here to my office and go, check this out, Michael. I found something amazing. You and I were having a conversation the other day. Oh, we were talking, Michelle and I were hanging out probably 2 or 3 days ago. We were talking about there's almost not been a better time for the record label, the major label side of the industry, pitching to them. They're looking harder than they've ever looked before, yet we've both noticed that the number of submissions coming in for the major label stuff has dropped off because people have given up. The bar's too high. Film and TV is easier. And yes, I'm very guilty of pushing the whole, you know, instrumental stuff on film and TV. But for those of you who are legit songwriters, you can do both. You don't have to stop doing one to do the other. As a matter of fact, you may sit down to write a song and find out that it's a better instrumental piece for film and TV. Or sit down to do an instrumental piece for film and TV and go, there's that magic melody. And then go, this one should be a song. So I'm not nuts, right? There is like a, for lack of a better word, kind of almost a sense of desperation or the A&R people are a little hornier than they've ever been to find great stuff now.
I think it's open, more open than it's ever been. For the first time, I think that it's not about being a part of a big, huge camp,
mm-hmm.
or you don't have to be one of Dr. Luke's writers, or it's, they are looking for great songs wherever they come from.
They want to find the next Dr. Luke.
They're looking for, and it's also, we're sort of in a phase where labels are competing with online independent artists. There are so many great independent artists that are making strides. So right now, they want to hear from everybody. They want to hear everything. They don't want to miss out on the next great artist because they, you know, were too stubborn or too, you know, oh, I don't want it. No, they want to hear in everything from anyone. So, you know, as long as it's a hit and it's, and you know, not even so much a hit, I just think they're open for new ideas. People who are pushing the envelope, anything that sounds sort of original, originality, unique, it just,
they're
open.
Pushing the envelope, being original and unique. Now, somewhere out there, somebody watching that's creating gobbledygook that in their mind, it's like, you guys never forward anything that's original or unique. You only want the same old formulaic crap. There is a difference between hearing something that's original, in quotes, unique, in quotes, versus original, unique, it sounds like a hit, right? So how do you draw that comparison?
So this is, you know, there's, like I was saying, there's a hybrid. There has to be some sort of, let's say you go with a really unique top line singing melody. Well, then that music, because something has to be straightforward. So if your drums and your bass line and your, you know, that those chords, the production sounds like everything that's on the radio, but your lyrics are really telling this very unique story, or your singing lyric is really has a lot of movement. There has to be some sort of push-pull in between the music and sort of the singing melody. That's, to me, I think what creates the originality. Some things it's tough because, again, like I was saying, it's like this song is great and all the elements are there and it's got strings and it's got this mm-hmm. and it's got that. And then, you know, I think there's thinking out of the box too far. I've heard some things that I'm like, wow, this is so unique, but it's tough to mix in to the radio. Right. It's like there aren't a lot of artists who are doing it, and I really want to encourage those people, like, be the artist and put this out. It's a tough call, but I think there has to be a little bit of mainstream kind of compatibility. It's more of a hybrid. It's like if you can kind of mix a couple of genres, no matter what they are, that's, you know, that's what works. But lyrics at the end of the day, you're, you know, full songs, that's what it comes down to, is lyrics.
And it's sadly ironic and somewhat funny to me that I completely agree about the lyric thing, especially in Nashville, but very much so in pop music. There's so many people that hold such a high standard for lyrics, yet we all turn on the radio and we hear, you know, "Move Me, Groove Me." It still makes it onto the radio, and you just go, how? I feel guilty sometimes that we can't forward, you know, "I'm going to move you, groove you" stuff, because it's been done a million times and it's way dated. And yet the members aren't wrong when they say, but that junk makes it to the radio. Why does it make it to radio? In this day and age, why do bad lyrics that are shallow, repetitive, and banal still make it to the radio?
In my opinion, I think there's always something. So you can have a very simple lyric, but if your production, you've got this killer breakdown dance part. One of my favorite songs last year was the Skrillex song with Justin Bieber, "Where Are You Now That I Needed You?" And it had this really weird little flute thing that would come in, and it's kind of part dance, part dubstep, part, like, I don't even know. It's like all that, it wasn't a formulaic, it was not a formulaic song. It wasn't verse, chorus.
A hook. That the flute thing was the
flute
hook.
Yeah, it's like even the singing wasn't even the hook. He just kind of said one line over and over. But yeah, there's always something. I mean, and "Where Are You Now That I Needed You?" You know, "Now That I Need You," it's not that compelling, but it's kind of, it's not what you say, it's how you say it sometimes. Mm-hmm. So I think that's how lyrics, you know, that's how people, I mean, to me, Bruno Mars, I was going to bring up Bruno.
Oh, yeah.
One of my absolute favorite writers. Nobody writes more simple and more, he's just so simple. His storytelling is, it's just down the line. You're getting every step by step. His writing is very step by step, but all the lyrics are simple. You know, I'll use an example. In one of his lyrics, he says, "From When I Was Your Man," he says, "The same bed, but it feels like it's feels just a little bit bigger now." And I've heard people, you know, write things like, "It's so, I'm still so alone in this bed without you," or "This bed is so big without you."
The empty bed syndrome.
Yeah, the empty bed syndrome. But same bed. So he's starting out automatically. It's like almost a backward sentence. It's kind of like, same bed, but it feels just a little bigger now. You know what I mean? It's like, that's very conversational, very simple. All his rhyme schemes, "now," "same," "down," "name." It's like our song on the radio, but it don't sound the same. Like, don't. As opposed to does it. It's mm-hmm. the smallest things, you know, and people say that all the time. "I hear our song on the radio and it makes me really sad." Well, this is a different, he's saying the exact same thing that you're saying. Our song on the radio, but it don't sound the same. You're getting right to the point. It's making an impact. These rhymes are so simple. It's not anything, it's just super easy, but I think it's conversational. It's, this is how he would say this to a friend. You know, I hear a lot of people say, I see your friends and it makes me sad. And it's like, when our friends talk about you, all it does is just tear me down. It's like, that's not anymore. It's just super simple lyric. So,
it's the way people talk.
It's, yeah, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. For me, starting with something backwards, same bed, that's the great start for a first line. Instead of, I feel like, or, you know, when I look in your eyes, that's a tough one. It's just super, yeah, it's hard to build your story from there. But if you say, your eyes are like, or your eyes did something, eyes don't actually go out and do something. But, you know, I just think it's using metaphors and being creative.
Do you study other people's music by intent, or I know you do it by osmosis, because all of us in the industry, you can't turn on the radio in your car and not be analyzing it's sadly a plague, something we're plagued with as music industry professionals. It's just really hard to sit down and get goosebumps. Maybe you get it the first play, but by the end of the song, you're listening to the hi-hat going, wow, 16th notes there, that's interesting, or look at the simplicity in that lyric. So do you sit down with headphones at home and study what makes a Bruno Mars song work and find that that helps you as a writer? Not that you're copying him, but understanding why he did that?
I like to feel songs. And when something grabs me, I just, oh my gosh, like See a Chandelier. Mm. Oh my gosh. I mean, the lyrics are brilliant, but it's the melody. It's familiar. It sounds like something that we've heard before. There's only so many melodies. So a lot of melodies we are hearing over and over. I mean, Sam Smith, Stay With Me, you know, there's, now we're having lawsuits. It's, Blurred Lines, whatever it is. The melodies are simple. Nobody's making an original melody, but I think it's that familiarity, but also the feeling that it gives you. So I will study a good feeling, but I like to listen to music and just sort of, I mean, I think all music kind of influences you when you're listening, but I actually don't like to listen. I think that there are a lot of writers who sit down and say, okay, let's listen to, you know, a Max Martin song or a Stargate song or something that this, you know, great producer did, what Adele is doing, and let's try to get the vibe of that. And I think you have to take their overall broad feeling and how it makes people feel and narrow it down. But you have to have your own voice and it has to feel original.
And that's the hardest part.
That's the hard part. You just kind of get vibe off of that and you want it to sound like it can play after those songs. But no, I think studying sometimes can be hurtful more than helpful.
Let's go to film and TV songs for the use of songs in film and TV for a minute, because Michelle is one of the rare people I know who comes from the record side of the industry that really gets the film and TV side. So many of the requests we get, I'm going to leave out instrumentals for now and talk about songs. They often want songs that sound like radio hits, and they expect us to hold to this bar that's up here. Does that sound like a radio hit? And then they don't want to give you any money up front. They want to take 100% of your publishing. It's like, why would anybody want to put that much effort into something and then give them 100% of the publishing for no money up front? Which I would make that bet on a really special and prolific publisher that gets a lot of great placements. If I knew them personally, I would probably make that bet sometimes. But they ask you to do all this stuff and achieve this level of perfection, and then the song ends up being background source music in a bar, and it sounds like it's this far away and muffly. It's like, why do they do that to us? What's your feeling? Is there a way to cheat the system, if you will, to make stuff that sounds like a hit but maybe doesn't have that level of effort put into writing an amazing lyric? Sounds like a hit, but ain't a hit.
You know, I think always put your best foot forward, because here's the thing. You don't want a bunch of sound-alikes, but that if it's going to get heard, you never know where that song's going to go. Mm-hmm. So I come from the idea that, I mean, I've had moments in the studio where it's like, no, I'm just going to lay this down really quick, and, you know, I'm just going to lay down the reference, and it's pitchy, or it's, we just didn't fix it, and then something happens, we don't finish the song, and then it goes out, and it's like somebody wants to cut it, and it's like, that's the worst vocal, or they don't want to cut it because I just wish I'd taken more time on it. And just, so for me, it's always, 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 always put your best foot forward. Always make sure that it's a hit or what you think is a hit. Because, it, you know, film and TV people, it really comes down to that music editor. And I always tell people that first 45 seconds is crucial. They're really... The directors and the producers, they have their vision, they're more, but, you know, they know what they want. But really, it's the music editor in there, like, you know, and no offense to music editors, but it's like they got their bag of Cheetos, they have a million things to do, and they're just like, 30 seconds, yeah, that'll work, that won't work. That, and it's like, some of them are more creative, they'll listen a minute in, and they're like, wow, when it really gets to 45 seconds, that's the best place. But when you have more time, or depending upon what their budgets are, they're more creative. But most of the time, they've only got a few minutes, they have a lot to edit, and it's like, 30 seconds, that doesn't work, you're out. Like, so it's tough. But
and a different standard depending on the kind of show. There's the reality
show.
TV decision-making process. There's the NCIS, which is certainly a level up from that. I've been watching a new show on Showtime called Billions. Eskimo scores it. And I can't remember. Richard Black, I believe, is the music soup's name. I think he's based in New York. Some of the best music supervision I've heard in a while. So there are these different levels of music supervision. Not that one is necessarily better. I believe that a really good music supervisor goes, hey, I'm working on a reality show, and this is really what I need for that. Now I'm working on NCIS, which is not brain surgery, but it's not reality TV. And now I'm working on, you know, Empire. There is a show that requires an incredible amount of attention to the music. The new show, which I recorded last night but haven't watched yet, Vinyl, which premiered on HBO last night, you know the music is, it's going to carry the show. So just know when you're writing that it could end up in any of those scenarios, and they won't all be looked at the same way.
It's true. So, higher budget blockbuster films, they're always, you know, they usually want the hits, but they also want soundalikes. But those soundalikes have to be top-notch, high quality, you know, everything from the mixing to the production to the, you know. And here's the other thing, though. When you get into that level of film, if there's something they like, they'll put the money into it to have you go back in and make it right and produce it. And
on a film, because like, they've got the time to do it.
Yes.
Versus episodic TV where they've got a week.
Yeah. Time and the money, too. Yeah. And that really comes down to amazing lyrics and amazing melody. I had a friend that wrote the theme song for the Wizard of Oz movie that came out a few years ago. And they looked long and hard for that song. It was really important to have the right feeling, the emotion, the lyric, the everything. And she must have pitched about 20 songs before she finally got a yes with Mariah Carey. And I think it's just, you know, lyrics are paramount. It's once you get to that level. But, you know, some TV shows, they just really want soundalikes.
Yeah. Let's listen to another song.
Great.
And this one is called Whenever I Think of Love.
Like we know we need us. It's not your physical beauty, girl, it's more than that. Don't get me wrong, baby, I still trip for that. That body baby hot, it drives me crazy. I'll spend my life from there with you and not be lazy. But it's more than that. No more than the way you look, girl, it's how you act. It's the way you treat me. It's how you look at me, girl, it's the way you hold me. It's the little things you do, girl, it's driving me crazy. Girl, the way you dress, baby, very snazzy. It's the fact that I feel like a king, honey, cause I'm better than queen. Or that my life flip, right from where it's been. It's the way you make me feel, girl, what I'm with you. It's the fact that I know with you, girl, I got a refuge. And that even if I feel like I can come home to you, baby, honey. And that is why I say you all about love, baby, honey. And that is why I say you all about love.
Whenever I think of you, I remember when love's so about. Whenever I think of you, get this funny, funny feeling.
Stone cold player, but they're wrong. They said I never stick with a girl again, wrong. They claim I was a mean heartbreaker, still wrong. But yeah, I did play the fields. I did take my fair share of the honeys out. I did mix and mingle, maybe just to test my clout. I was active, proactive, and prevalent. I knew I had it, so I went out and used my talent. Been to the east, to the west, to the north, south. Been there, done that, probably done it. If you can name it, the words with the wrong honey. Then I was searching and under the influence of my homies. Then girl, I met you and all that I knew about love was rotting. Other than window and that was shocking. If you think love was pain, so you see. But since you met, I've been counting my gains. And why I can say that you all about love. And why I can say that you all about love. Baby, honey. And that is why I say you all about love. Baby, honey.
And that is why I say
you love. All right. All righty. Great. So, all right. So this is kind of an example of what I was saying about hybrid. One of the things that I do like this about this song, it's very musical. There's a lot of melody, and it's very melodic, but then it's still, it's kind of a rap song. I thought it was going to be a straightforward pop song, kind of R&B pop song, and then it has this rap, which is kind of cool. For me, I would say this, the things that stand out are kind of the things that we talked about with lyrics. First of all, this singer sounds great. Whoever is singing this, kudos, because that's always half the battle if your demo sounds good. And it's interesting because I think our ears are just trained when we hear a good singer, you're automatically kind of like, that's not too bad. So that's always great. It's it's half the battle to keep people listening. So the singing and the rapping, solid performances, very good. So the lyrics, the hook and the verse are very similar. We've got some repetitive lyrics. Whenever I think of love, I remember you loving me. So there's Robin, who has been here for a long time. When I first started working here, Robin talked a lot about payoff lines. And actually, it's something that kind of has helped me in my writing, too. And I always tell writers, that payoff line is really the key. And leading up to it, it's like that last line, it's the anchor. It's the, it holds the, it's everything. It's, for me, I think that country music in Nashville, you talked about Nashville, it's some of the most prolific writing because the storytelling is detailed. It's always, we know the color of the truck, what time it was, when they got to the bar, who was at the bar. It's like anything, even if they're using the same lyrics, it's always kind of the same thing. And I think that that rule applies to all songs. Whenever I think of love, nice starter lyric, but I think it's what you put after it. Whenever I think about love, I remember you loving me. So now we've sort of said love twice, and we haven't quite said anything yet. When I think about love, I remember what love's about.
Yeah.
So we've said love three times now, and we've also said whenever twice. I like a good repeat. Whenever I this, whenever I that. Great. Whenever is a great word, but I'd like to hear a little bit more conversation, a little bit more detail in terms of, I remember what love's about. What is love about? What does love mean to you? It's mm-hmm. sort of like, I guess, giving the details. I talk a lot about general statements when I'm talking to people. I remember you're all about love is very general. Whenever I think of you, it's kind of like these are general statements, but you're not saying exactly what you remember about love, what they did to remind you of love, what is it about them that makes you feel love. It's like there are all these questions that are kind of left hanging in the balance. And then I have to say this all across the board for everyone. Baby, baby, darling, darling is really, those are tough because I think the last time we heard a good baby, baby lyric was probably when we heard about Justin Bieber with Baby, 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 his, you know, first really big hit. He did that.
Already, what,
yeah.
6, 7, 8 years ago?
Yeah, it's been a while. But it was tough because, I mean, not tough, it was almost like he kind of got over because the melody was familiar, it was like very sing-songy, like almost little kid style. And I feel like unless you're kind of using it in a cliche way, and you're really poking fun at the baby, baby, or darling, darling, then, or you're going for a 50s thing, or it's attached to something, always stay away from baby and darling in the chorus. It's filler. And I, you know, I don't like to use words like cliche. I also know this is someone's, you know, this is someone poured the, yeah. I can hear that you spent a lot of time. The demo sounds great. The vocals sound great. Everything sounds great. Lyrically, this is tough, and it's tough for any writer that would have wrote this. It sounds like filler.
Would you keep the track and throw away the lyrics and try and start all over if that was a project you were working on, or should they just move on to another song? Filler is a very important concept. I get asked this question. It's actually in my list of questions for you today. People will write us and say, aren't they ever looking for B-sides? Aren't they looking for filler? And I say, no, they're looking for an album full of hits. Very few people ever have that, but they're looking for it.
Yeah, they're definitely not looking for filler. It's, yeah, baby. So another thing that I noticed in this, you asked about the track. So I think that some things can be saved. So for me, this track, with a different maybe melody, someone else might hear this and write something completely different because it really comes down to the pocket. Someone might have a melody for this that's so unique. It's kind of like this melody is really on the beat, really in the pocket. And, you know, I'm finding it's kind of like people that have really unique phrasing, waiting a beat to come in. Like the way that the rap is set up, it's almost like the rap verse, the phrasing is a little bit, it's very unique. So I wouldn't say throw this away. Mm-hmm. To me, it's more about the singing verse and the singing chorus. The rap has some areas that, you know, the lyrics are a little bit simple. It's those rhyme schemes. You know, we kind of talked about Bruno Mars earlier. He's got these really simple rhyme schemes, but the way he's describing it is so unique, you know?
I circled the word proactive. This may be go down in history is the only song where a guy used the word proactive or prevalent right after.
I like that too.
And I thought, got to give you points for thinking outside of the box on that, making it work in the context of this.
I totally caught that too. And I think with phrasing, you have a little bit, you have more of an option to fit some cool things in and to kind of play around with the lyrics. If you don't think about the phrasing having to be so on or so simple or so, it's almost like the hook, when he starts to say baby, baby, I want the chords to follow the melody a little bit more. So another thing that happens with choruses, not just this one, but other songs that I've heard, the melody kind of keeps going and then it starts to feel monotonous because the music isn't changing. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like maybe this track was already done and then the writer wrote to the track, because mm-hmm. that can sometimes be the case, and then the producer doesn't change the track. I would say in this case, this song could be saved with when the baby baby comes in, a little bit of a melody change, but also if those chords change and the dynamic of that, sounds like the chorus is a little bit long, but the second half of that chorus could be really unique with a little bit of rhythmic play, some chord changes to help out the melody some. But really, lyrically, it's tough because we haven't said enough. I'm not sure I'm not sure exactly what the sentiment is. Love me, honey, don't you ever leave me. Love me, don't you ever let me go, as the last line.
This has been said
infinitely. And it's tough because also you want to think, why am I not letting this person go? What is it about them? Describe them to me. Tell me what it is about them that's making you write this.
I'm so glad you're saying this because we get a lot of grief from our members. A lot of people don't renew their memberships, I believe, because of insight like this. And it's not just one screener. It's the entire industry that thinks, like, tell me why she left you.
Yeah. Yes.
I want to know more of the story. As my friend Ralph Murphy always says, invite the listener in, and you do that with detail. The song that I play, the piano vocal song that I've played 100 times on the show, the opening line is, I can hear the truck tires on the gravel road. You would never think about that in a million years, but we all know what it sounds like, and we're there.
It's visual.
Puts you right there.
Yes.
And then it talks about, but she's coming down the road, doesn't have the radio on. Oh, something's different. And then she comes up to the porch, but she rings the doorbell. Normally, she'd just walk right in. So you put those things together, truck tires, gravel road, doesn't have the radio on, and she rings the doorbell. Buddy, you're about to lose a girlfriend.
Yeah.
And we know that in three lines that didn't say it because the picture has been painted.
Yes, you can see it. You can see it. One thing I would say in this song, maybe I would start with the line that makes you think. So I would say, instead of saying whatever I think of love, or whenever I think of love, I would say that line first that captures you. It's kind of the same thing as the Bruno Mars thing where you're saying same bed, but it feels just a little bigger now. So I feel like if you start with whatever makes you think of love when you think of this person and a really impactful lyric, and then say, whenever I think of love, and then something else happens when I think of love. I feel like that's how you can do something repetitive. I really like the idea of a really detailed visual lyric, very intellectual lyric, and then something really simple to follow. It's like one really difficult, one really simple, one really difficult, one really simple. I think that just gives it a little bit of life. So you're still, I mean, even the idea of love me, you know, don't you ever let me go. It's okay to end with that if everything building up to that has been some sort of push-pull and really supportive lines, so that whenever you say, don't you ever let go, it's like people got it. They know why you want to hang on or what it is, but it's hard to make all those supportive lines for don't you ever let me go. But I think sometimes just thinking backwards, it's the smallest thing that can make it happen.
I like the fact that you call it the push-pull. There's another phrase that people use to describe it. I once had somebody call it cognitive dissonance, which I thought was a little heavy, but, you know, you're right. It's that push pull. It's just a great, simple way. You've effectively used simple words to describe that tool, that songwriting tool.
Yes.
Yay.
Yes.
Let's do one more because we're getting close to running out of time. For those of you who must be relatively new to the show, you're asking, why don't I plug the music right into Ustream? I can't. We would have to upload the songs in Ustream, and then every time I play it, it mutes us so that if Michelle wanted to talk over the song, she can't. And then a lot of times when we tried to do it in the past, we'd switch between the audio for the music and the microphone. We get feedback, and then it mutes everything. It's a mess. So that's why we play it over the stereo. Sorry.
One more second before you move on.
Yeah.
I'm reading now. I haven't been reading the comments, but I do want to address something. Someone said that this is a hip-hop song and that the explanation is in the rap verses. I do want to say this. So you can't rely on the verses, or you can't think that people are going to be, that they're going to get you or that they're going to get it. You have to deliver from the second that the song comes on. Everything that I said about those first 30 seconds, those first five lines that they hear are so important because you want to grab them right off the bat. You can't wait for them to get to the chorus and then be like, wait, just get to the chorus or just get to the bridge. You're going to love the bridge. It's like, no, that first, and especially because this is the chorus, and we didn't know that it was a rap song because it sounded like there were about 16 bars. I'm guessing that's how it felt. before that rap verse came in, maybe even longer, because it looks like there's a hook and a verse too before we even get to the rap verse. So yes, and love songs are kind of the easiest songs to write, but again, it's expressing it and finding a new way to express that. Everybody's talked about love. Everybody's been in love, lost love, wrote about love. That's not new. Just saying I love you is not enough. Just saying I remember to love you. You've got to make specific details about what is different about your love. What is different about this time? What is different about this person?
I buried her in the backyard because she didn't love me anymore. They will listen to the rest of the song if you start
out
with that.
They will. That's a good way to capture them.
As you're sitting there describing it, other than my demented thought that I just had, you're describing a book. You're describing a movie. A movie, you know, the first big reveal in a movie is almost always 15 minutes in. It's a bit of a formula. In a book, if first of all, you got to have a great title or they don't open the cover. If the first sentence of the first chapter isn't good, and you happen to be in Barnes & Noble and you look at that, you're not buying the book.
Yes.
This is the same. You got to grab them right away.
Yeah. Or it's like a romantic comedy that's really cliche. It's like you see the trailer and you know he's going to end up with a girl and they're going to have a bunch of moments that are like bumping into each other or something. You know, right. It's like you don't want it too formulaic. The best movies, the ones that win the Oscars or that keep people, you know, talking, are the ones that you don't know where it's going. You don't know what's happening. You just... wow, you know, it's relatable. People, because everyone's been in love, you want to be as relatable and honest about your experience as possible. Not poetry, not general, not what you think people should think about love, your actual personal thoughts and experiences, or thoughts and experiences from other people if you haven't been in love. That's okay.
And just for the record, I've never buried a girlfriend or an ex-wife in the backyard. Never even thought about it till today's show. Just trying to come up with something different enough to get your attention.
That's okay,
we are moving on to a song called River Keep Rising, and let's have a listen.
Started off as friends, easy as a summer stream, playing songs and building fires, talking on separate dreams. Little did I know this gentle flow was pooling in my heart. Now I'm drowning in this current as you struggle with your part. You know I never asked for this way. I don't know what to do, what to say. I wish I could turn it all back to the yesterday. But this river is rising in my you feel confused now that my friendship's done love. I can't hold this river back or return to once what was. Now there's thunder in the valley, there's droplets on the pain. I wish my good could keep you dry, but I just can't stop this rain. No, I never asked for it down this way. Tides have shifted now, feeling slipped away. I wish I could turn it all back to yesterday. This river is rising. coffee's getting cold as the neon evening fades. Inside I hear the river run, inside I feel it rage. Liquid jets and poison breath, there's a can.
All right.
Great, great. Once again, I have to commend everyone for their talent.
And courage.
Yes, talent, yeah. and courage, definitely, to send in your song. I'll say this. This is a strong performance. Putting music together, melodies, the whole track, the playing, the performance, everything, it's not an easy thing to do. So, nice job. This style, we get a lot of listings for adult contemporary, especially for TV and film, and it really comes down to what they're looking for. Adult contemporary it's almost a bigger audience, I think, because there's different ways to spin it. Like, this is something that I don't know is would be considered contemporary, adult contemporary on the pop side of like an Adele or Sam Smith, but in terms of... I think more for like, to me, it's more soft rock ballad, mm-hmm. Kind of fits in that world, which still, a lot of people are looking for that, background, whatever it kind of is.
Very 80s influence, yes. Largely.
And 90s, I think, too.
The guitars brought me back.
Yes.
Overall style, but the guitars, I went, okay, you can almost tell how old this gentleman, assuming it was the guy that wrote it, and we get requests for stuff from a certain era for film and TV.
Yes, yes. So to me, there's a couple different things going on here. It's very soft rock kind of ballady, but I think there are also some kind of cool country blues influences. But overall, the tough part is it's the production and the contemporary feel. I think, like I've said probably a million times, melody is just, you're going to always, a great melody, a great lyric can always go anywhere. This is actually a case where I would say, in terms of production, I think anything can always be reproduced. So while the production sounds good, I don't know that it's contemporary enough for probably a lot of listings.
Right.
It's just the arrangement, even that the smallest things in terms of the guitar, it's the style of it. An adult contemporary song, you hear someone like the guys that do the Renegade song, I can't think of their name. Living like a renegade. I don't know, I love that song.
I can't remember my kids' names.
That's cool. There's kind of a pickup, I think, even in ballads or phrasing, or there's sort of a uniqueness where the genres are kind of a hybrid genre. So mm-hmm. even with adult contemporary, rock it's a little bit more progressive. And I think this one just comes down to production in terms of forwarding this. That would be my first sort of reservation. My other thought is really, here's a moment where metaphors are a little too many metaphors and not enough direct lyrics. The storyline, it's like there's so many great things here. Started out as friends, easy as a summer stream. I love the consistency of the water. You go from the stream to the gentle flow. There's a pulling in the heart. Now you're drowning in this current. And in the chorus, you're talking about the river. I like the consistency of the theme. My thought is that the metaphors, like talking our separate dreams, little did I know this gentle flow. It's kind of like, that's when we get a little bit too poetic, and that's where I want the real direct lines. How did this go wrong? Because it's like, things were good, but you never really said when things got bad. You just kind of say, now I'm drowning in this current as you struggle with your part. What are we struggling with? What's the part? I feel like...
That unfinished story we were talking about before. It's like, tell me the rest.
Yes. So I think it's good to... It's that balance of intellectual lines, poetic lines, the beauty, and then the really direct, when this happened, I felt like this. So there's a lot of really good metaphors here. My other thought would be in the chorus. It's tough. Two-line choruses are just... Especially when it's a repeat, this river keeps rising in my heart. I want something that's a little bit gonna hold on or help it and move it along a little bit, because
it didn't pop enough.
Yeah.
First of all, if you're gonna, I mean, even attempt a two-line chorus, it's got to be so spectacular. It's just got to smack you in the face, and this doesn't. It really sounded like the rest of the verse.
Yes.
And even if he had repeated it twice and made it a four-line chorus using that same lyric, that wouldn't have worked well either. So to me, it's like, oh, you let me down when I got there. I wanted the chorus to be big and explosive and impactful and emotional. And instead, it was very Gordon Lightfoot. You know, it's just like a little too laid back.
Yes. It's definitely, I think that the lyric could be stronger, but also the melody is kind of, you know, a little bit, it doesn't progress, I guess, as big as it should. But for me, it's the storytelling, because this river rising in my heart, right before that, I want to hear a lyric that kind of leads up to that and really tells the story. So this is definitely in order. There's some good metaphors here. But, you know, you say, you know, I never asked for it to turn this way. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I want you to say why it turned this way. And, you know, just tell us more. To me, those are general statements. I think there's a different way to kind of express why, what happened, and what you're feeling about it, more so than the general statement of it happened. And I think leading up to "This River Keeps Rising in My Heart," you've got the water theme, but I think just digging in just a little bit more to it, just express yourself directly. So some really good metaphors here, visuals, but it's, yeah, I think there could just be a little bit more direct lines telling us exactly what's going on.
All right. Well, I appreciate the input on that. And I looked up at the clock and went, oh my gosh, the, not the Oscars, the Grammys have started. It's almost Oscar season. So can you come back in like 2 or 3 weeks and do another one of these? Because I really wanted to give these guys a chance to ask you questions. I'm sorry we didn't get to that. But I hope that something that you learned today is that this is the level of the people sitting in the room here at Taxi. They care about you guys.
I really care.
Yeah.
I love music.
They want you to be successful. Nobody is trying to hold you down. And look at the level of expertise. I mean, just ridiculously good at what you do. And,
thanks, Michael.
I appreciate you so much and love having you in the room. And I forgot to tell you the other day, I wanted to tell you this 100 times. You typically sit at the workstation that that Katy Perry sat at all the time. Oh. Not that that really means anything other than she told me once, I sit down there so the guys don't bother me, because the guys would always try and sit on both sides of her, so she would sit down on that end to avoid them. And I just thought it was noteworthy that you sit in the same cubicle down there. But
that's cool.
Yeah, I mean, this lady's a star. You really are. You're a special, special woman. And I really love your whole thought process into making your career happen. You didn't just want it to happen. You didn't just will it to happen. You actually made it happen by taking steps. And look at you, you know. So congratulations.
Thank
and
you.
Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me. This was awesome.
It goes by quickly,
really,
doesn't
awesome.
It?
Yeah, that was fast.
Thank you guys for watching and hanging out with us today. And we will be back. Am I here next week? Yes, I'm here next week. We'll be back with another Taxi TV. And I promise to have Michelle back sometime in March, okay? And thank you, guys. Enjoy the Grammys, and talk to you soon. Bye, you guys.